Hello, Malty Mumseries. I'm Ralphie. Welcome to Whisky U 580. And thank you to Edward for the malt mention. I'll be with you in a minute. Don't go away. Just chill out. Make yourself comfortable. Pour a glass of whisky. Make sure you've got some water as well. Make sure your phone's on silent or in another room. Even better. Turn off the television if it's on. Remove any unnecessary distractions, such as the modern world is cluttered with. And I will just complete my anti-static dusting here in the Manx Bothy. I've had to tidy the place up a little bit, you see, malt mates, because it's been getting rather dusty. And I have two of these pictures, you see, up in the top of my shelf. Rightio, they're there for a reason. I will be telling you about that reason later on in this review. But in the meantime, the anti-static duster, which I bought especially for the Manx Bothy, which is why it looks so fluffy and clean, well, we can lose that. Because we've got a malt whisky to review. I have been to Scotland recently. Yes, I've been on location, and that is why this is the first of a three-part review. Now, I've not done any of them for quite a while, in which I start off here in the Bothy reviewing a whisky which I bought at a distillery. I tell you all about it. I tell you why I bought it. I give it a malt mark because it is a single malt whisky. And then I tell you a little bit more about the forthcoming on location. Yes, I know you've been anticipating this. Well, some of you have. And after which I'm going to conclude by introducing these two pictures here. They're there for a purpose, a very important purpose. Yes, something to do with Bonneville, but no more spoilers. This is a bottle of Wemyss malts. They're an independent bottler. Single malt. It's a single cask malt because Wemyss bottlers, an independent bottler, as I mentioned, mention it again because it's what they specialise in, although they now own a distillery. Very important that. Many independent bottlers who are going the distance, who are investing in the future, are investing in distilleries, which are going to be the source of production for the whiskies they can no longer buy through the brokers, because it's a sign of the times. You see, independent bottlers need independent casks from a variety of distilleries in order to be able to offer variety. It's the tradition. It's the way it's always been done. It's just the way it is. And there's no exception here with Wemyss malts. They have a blended malt range, which they don't give age statements. They don't really talk about the distillery. They do an alternative style of bottling where they describe the essential characteristics of the flavour primarily and the smell to a certain extent, and then bottle it as such. And they also do single cask bottlings, which is what I tend to look out for, because they can offer pretty good value when you have an independent bottler who is very mindful of the importance of casks in maturation over time. Now, this is a Glen Scotia. It was distilled in 1991, which was a few years ago now, bottled in 2014, specifically to commemorate the opening of their distillery in the East Nuke of Fife. If you're Dutch, don't start laughing. I don't want to hear all you Dutch malt mates laughing. It's called the Nuke. That's what it is. It just happens to be the Nuke of Fife. And there's an area in the Nuke of Fife called Kingsbarns, which was originally an estate from ancient times in which the King of Scotland had his massive storage containers for all the grain that he took in taxes and harvested from landowners in the vicinity, hence the name Kingsbarns. And now an old building on the estate is now a small working craft distillery, which I've been watching for a while and is now starting to come of age. I'm going to talk a little bit more about it, but before I do, I'll tell you why. When I visited the distillery, I bought this bottle and I didn't buy their own single malt whiskey. Simples. It's not ready yet. The distillery is still young. They haven't got whiskey old enough to be called whiskey. It hasn't reached that essential, that legislated and legal minimum of 3 complete years maturation prior to being able to be called whiskey and bottled as whiskey. Under 3 years of age, all malted barley single malt whiskey produced at a distillery needs to be called new make or cleric or whatever they want, anything but whiskey. Now, Kingsbarns do bottle their own new make spirit, which you can buy if you visit the distillery. Just go for Google Maps. Fantastic. Go and have a look at the location on the east coast of Scotland, then home in and have a look at the pictures of the distillery. It's all online. I don't even have to give you an address. KingsBarns. Kingsbarns. There you go. Glen Scotia is a fine old distillery which has had mixed fortunes in recent years. The irony is when it was looking a mess and nobody wanted to visit it was when it was producing some absolutely fantastic, superb single malts. And they occasionally pop up now and again. In fact, traditionally the blenders ranked Glen Scotia as one of the finest malts for blending to come out of the Campbellton area. And there you go. This is bottled at 46%. It's unchill filtered, it's natural colour. I do approve of that because I'm just simply going to get a better experience on the nose. Wonderful, rich grain nose. It's complex, it's slightly spicy, and there's hints of citrus and there's hints of nuts. This is actually quite an intrinsically complex whiskey, which I've noticed really seems to go the distance. It all depends on the casks. This is a distillery, single malt distillery, that is really quite chameleon depending on the casks that it is matured in. In other words, the casks with their own individual characteristics, which they bring to maturation of the content. Essentially, some malt whiskies out there don't change much. They're still easily recognisable no matter what cask you put them in. And an obvious example of that would be Lafroy. I mean, it's a very obvious example. But there's other distilleries, and the Campbelltown distilleries are all like this. Springbank and even Glengyle, I'm noticing it, is that they tend to kind of reflect and adopt and absorb the provenance of the actual casks. So what you have here is a single cask. Just give you a little bit more detail in this. There were a total of 294 bottles, and as far as I am aware, the only place you can buy this is actually if you visit the distillery. Now, just a reminder, malt mates, it doesn't matter whatever distillery you visit anywhere in the world, you want to ask them in the visitor centre at the shop, do you stock a whiskey which is only available at the distillery? Can I see it, please? How much is it? Because these distillery-only whiskies can be really quite interesting over the long term to collectors. There you go. Now you know. I'm Ralphie and I'm just sharing. How about the taste of this stuff? Gentle walk in the glass, a stroll and roll. No shaky shakies. I've tried adding water. And it doesn't work. This is one of these single malts, a very rare example, where I'm not adding any water. The experience is better without it. It's rather fragile. It's 23 years old, but it's been a long, old 23-year journey. And it really comes across, particularly on the palate. You have a soft, toffeed, grainy nose, which kind of is sort of slightly vintage, veteran, old world, sawdust, cask residue, slightly leathery polish. It is not predominant and dominant age. It's subtle, whispering age. That's what it is. And it's the same in the palate. The arrival is remarkably long, and it heads into a kind of hit. It heads into a citrus note at the start of the development, and the development is really tongue-coating, but you're actually going in a flavour hunt initially until it settles down in the glass, opens up, until it kind of warms gently like a brandy or a cognac in the glass, in your hand. Whiskey can, old single malt whiskies tend to work like that. I would recommend this actually in a brandy balloon glass rather than a Glencairn. But of course I use Glencairns because I break fewer of them than I would of a brandy goblet. But it's a subtle, understated, complex, absolute old school character single malt of enormous personality, but vulnerability. It's not headstrong, it's not dominant, not assertive, it's restrained, it's even slightly retiring. You've got this kind of conversation, as I say, with any whiskey we taste, we have a conversation in the glass. But with this one, it's a slow conversation, full of meaning. It's not just chit-chat. Remarkably delicate. Honey, grain, rich. Slightly concentrated grain initially, and then it becomes quite ethereal. A touch of citrus icing sugar, hints of fructose in the background, which then morph into honey in the finish, with again that grain, a slight old yeast note, and some polish, gentle spices, a hint of vanilla, some slightly underbrewed English tea, weak tea, and then it just goes. It's an exquisite whiskey, and you know, in terms of the calibre of the experience for what I paid for it, and you know, basically, I tend to find a certain satisfaction of going to a distillery, and I don't stand there and ask for samples. Do you know what I do, malt mates? I take a bottle of whiskey with me, because it's the last thing any distillery is expecting. And I pour them a glass. When you visit a distillery, if you take your own whiskey and offer your glass of your whiskey to the visitors, you'll really get remembered because nobody else does it apart from Ralphie. 92 out of 100, it's a malt mark, it's a single malt, it's a fine, delicate, understated, wonderfully characterful Glen Scotia single malt from an independent bottler. And let me assure you, seafarers, there be treasures in that chests. In the treasure chests of independent bottlers, you may find demanding whiskies, alternative styles of whiskies, some challenging whiskies. But what you're finding is unblemished, unblended, as it is from the cask. No finishes, no blending up of single malts. It's what sets independent bottlers apart. And smaller independent bottling houses like Wemyss Malts, they've been in the business for quite a while, they know what they're doing, and they seem to have some pretty good stock. So go out and find it, malt mates. 92 out of 100. There's not that many whiskies these days that I score over 90. Take note. Delicious. It was a joy being given my tour around Kingsbarns Distillery, because I really, there's only a point in me visiting a distillery when I believe that they're kind of doing things that are going to be setting a good example to you, the viewer, the malt mate, wherever you may be. And I think Kingsbarns really ticks the boxes here, because it has been an idea which has been off the burner for so long, and yet it's such a good location. It has the provenance, you see. It shows. It also has its own artisanal well, its own water support source from water down in the bedrock. And it's a very mineral-rich water. It's water, when you taste it, you're tasting water with a flavour, with almost a seashell flavour, if I can say that. So that's another point to this small distillery. Also with Kingsbarns Distillery, they've started off investing the money where they really, really need to, in showing people round, in raising awareness for visitors to the distillery, in having a restaurant somewhere you could chill out and relax, you know, and tasting rooms where they organise all that sort of stuff, if you're interested. Definitely worth inquiring about. So I'm giving Kingsbarns a punt here, and quite rightly so, because I've been, done the tour, and I've had a lot of boxes ticked. And also the distillery itself, you walk in, and what really struck me in this open plan modern distillery is just how clean, immaculate it is. It is absolutely immaculate. And it's really kind of took a trick with me, because we don't mind a little bit of stir now and again in some of the old distilleries, because that's what old distilleries are. But modern distilleries are not trying to be too slavishly in recreating the past. They are being what they are at the moment in time. And importantly, at Kingsbarns, they've got all the modern fixtures and fittings. They've got modern lighting inside. They've got a visitor-friendly facility to allow ease of access round for the tour. And also they've got pot stills. Now, pot stills from Scottish still makers are hellish expensive. They really are. They cost a lot of money. So it's a big commitment. But at Kingsbarns, they've got them, and you'll see them, physically see them in the next video that I'm going to kind of release as part of this mini-series. And I'm going to interview Peter, the distillery manager. We're going to talk about yeast, which I tend to rather glibly call Saccharomyces cerevisiae, because that's what the yeast family is. All yeast comes from this family. But you talk to Scotch whisky distillers, what yeast do you use? They will say cerevisiae. This is the general purpose industry yeast. Whereas at Kingsbarns, the distillery manager has a brewing background, which means he's bringing brewing ideas into modern distilling, which, in, from my perspective, is important and very telling. He mentions a variety of yeast that he is using, which is not normal in Scotch whisky. It really isn't. And it really, you're seeing it come through in the overt fruitiness, something which is the complete antithesis of Islay malts, full fruit, lowland style, such as we've grown to expect from old school Bladnachs and some of the Linlithgows and Rosebanks and Little Mills. Wonderful. In the second video, I'm interviewing founder Doogie, in which he tells his story about the finances, you see, of organising it, and very importantly about how government can assist in small loans, and they are small loans, to help distillers retain their financial independence from traditional bank contracts. It is my opinion, and only opinion, I must stress that, malt mate, seriously, if I was running a business, I would not involve bank loans at any stage whatsoever, because I believe that they are poisonous, toxic. That's what I think of bank loans. As soon as you've got a bank loan, your business, you no longer have control of your company, in my opinion. And I speak from having observed this situation on several occasions with others. Enough said. I hope you enjoy this. I'm going to conclude with a big announcement. Ooh, Ralphie, what can it be? What are you going to tell us? Yes, some of you who have been paying attention will know that I'm going to Bonneville to compete in Speed Week 2016. Yes, I'm part of a motorcycle speeds trial team. I'm in the little bike. It's a 250 classic pushrod. Wonderful. That'll do me. Something a little bit old and classy. But like myself, I like to think. Anyway, I just happened to be over in Glasgow and I was discussing it with some malt mates on the rounds, as one does. And they said, Ralphie, we'd like to sponsor you. And I said, thank you very much. I tell you what, I'm going to have you up in the Manx Bothy for the rest of 2016. An acknowledgement of your sponsorship and support of my Bonneville mission. There's me sitting in my bike. You can follow me at Salty Wheels Blogspot. SaltyWhels. Blogspot. There we go. My malt motorcycle mission. Yes. Thank you to ScotchWhiskeyAuctions.com. for sponsoring me. Thank you to the Bon Accord Whiskey Bar, British Single Malt Whiskey Bar of the Year, no less, with its own whiskey clubs, a massive range, not just of single malt whiskies, but of fine cask ales. You're talking they have almost 1,000 varieties of different ales, all cask conditioned over the space of a year. Fantastic commitment. So here we are, the Bon Accord in North Street, Charing Cross in Glasgow. Go find malt mates, go find. And Scotch Whisky Auctions, who incidentally, because I may as well mention this in passing, at the moment this video vlog goes live online on YouTube for the whole world and the world beyond to see, three bottles are getting auctioned as fundraisers, not for me, but for the rest of my team, for my teammate, Chris, who's in a big bike, and it's expensive bike. Motorbikes, when they're being built for competition, are expensive. So it's to contributing towards his costs. So I've got three bottles. You can follow them and see how they do, and you never know. You might even want to bid yourself. But there we go. I'm going to be talking more as time goes on. We're now getting to a kind of critical stage where the bike's really nearly ready for me to show you. So I will be recording some reviews on location shortly around my motorcycle and its three different engines. Yep. I'm Ralphie. I've just completed a whisky review. I'm going to gather up my microfiber anti-static duster. Isn't it magnificent? I'm going to give one final dusting to these handsome pictures, which are now adorning the walls of the Manx Bothy. Well, sitting in the shelves, actually. And if you'd like to join me again shortly, I'll be on location, not once, but twice, in part two and part three of Whisky Review 580. There you have it. Now you know. There we go. And we'll see you soon. Here's the finishing shot. I think it's quite classy. It's got a certain kind of Hollywood sensibility about it. Kind of dramatic.